Hello, my name is Odrek Rwabwogo and I work at the Thomas Group as a business trainer and strategy support officer. I welcome you all to our podcast. The Thomas Group is a medium-sized business involved in agriculture, security, communication, and real estate, employing directly slightly over 400 people. Our biggest challenge in the last 21 years has been raising a skilled and reliable human capital to support growth. It is a challenge almost every business in Africa faces. This podcast is meant to help our officers and teams learn and improve their skill at work. It will also help hundreds of young people we speak to across Uganda in support of their enterprise growth. The podcast covers topics such as finance, sales, marketing, communication, and many more. This podcast is supported by the Thomas Foundation, our community giving arm. Enjoy. Hello. The purpose of these sessions, as we know, is to support the Thomas Group staff and management to raise both their capabilities as well as their performance. We also use these sessions to do a greater good, which is to share our experience over the years with those young entrepreneurs and business people who are out there making an effort to build their startups, who are in the middle of their businesses in Uganda and across Africa. We have now crossed to a new topic. It is called customer service. The second aspect for our discussion in regard to this customer service is something I call simply language. Language. Anything that doesn't have a language to simplify its understanding to people will be difficult to sell, let alone serve the needs of customers with this product. Many times I've spoken to you about learning our local languages and really developing interest in them. Why are you only interested in speaking English or French, languages of our captors, our former captors? Yet the one given to you freely by your parents and your motherland, you despise it. Now we are adding even Chinese. It seems to me Africans are only interested in the whole world, but not what is truly theirs. Okay, even these languages you claim to speak, I have had many graduates who neither speak nor write them well. I want to assume this is a consequence of lacking the grounding in the local languages. On Monday morning this week, I found some of our staff at the farm destroying something we call omurri. Beautiful play on R, omurri. Omurri is an extremely nutritious vegetable. In common English, it is called the amaranthus spinach. In Luganda, it is called ebuga. In other dialects, it's called goyi. These vegetables belong to a larger category in Runyankore we often call eshoji. Eshoji. Why were the staff doing this destruction? Well, there's no market and we don't understand it well, they answered. Now you can imagine my shock if you know my tastes with these vegetables and local foods. Because they don't have the knowledge base that comes from a rich language, they have ignored it, so they can't see the product and therefore they have no customers for it. Standing there in the garden and watching, I was reminded by this incident. Over time, I was young in communication at Tap Media. I would hear young ladies walking on stilettos, fellows in suits, trying to speak every inch look and speak every inch muzungus. They would talk about things like above the line, below the line, as their areas of specialization in marketing and advertising. I didn't understand then because I never went to a marketing school or an advertising agency. These terms really mean ATL or above the line, using television and radio and other media to reach customers, while below the line or BTL would be the direct connection with customers through events and promotions such as in-store promotions or the trucks you see making noise pollution all around our cities in Uganda. And later I also heard them say TTL, which means through the line. And through the line is just the best combination of both above and below the line. Now, look, I have no problem with these terminologies. They are a way to getting to understand advertising and marketing. However, I asked then, I still ask today, three questions. First, why do you throw around these words to customers or even newcomers into the industry without an explanation? Secondly, what is your own understanding of these lines? And can you put them to test in your language, a language the market in Uganda understands? Thirdly, what is your addition to this language? Given this seems to me like you are playing around with a box of only three lines, ATL, BTL, TTL.
Yet there must be a fourth dimension to this box. Even a fifth one, if you completely leave this box and think of a whole new world in language around these tools. Why do you limit yourselves to what the Muzungu has taught you? Why don't you use what he has taught you instead to interpret your world, your market, their preferences, your audiences in your own way? This might help you and someone on this market. Now, coming to this word eshoji, these plants which our staff were destroying thinking they are a weed in the garden were in the past among the major items given to an oncoming king at his crowning in Nkore. They would give a king a spear and a shield to symbolize his role in the defense of his nation, a milk pot to indicate provision for his people, a hoe and a shoji to show the richness of the land. They would give millet and other things, but I just want to focus on this. Now, from this eshoji, we have our verb in Runyachitara, okshoga, which means to grow and to expand. We also have an adjective, okshogoya, which means a boy turning 17 and beginning to grow a beard, thus becoming a man. Now, if you do not know the etymology of our local words, you are bound to misuse products and services, which we might serve to customers now and in future. You might misinterpret and poorly read some of your customers' needs because your frame of mind is only English, French, or Chinese. I'd like to close this point with a story, taken from December 24th, 1968. It's one of my all-time favorites. It was a couple of months before I came into the world, although my mother said I might have been born in September 1968. Three men, formerly fighter jet pilots, took to a shuttle called Apollo 8. They were the first people to orbit the moon, the first to see our universe outside of it. Their names, Frank Borman, James Lovell, and William Anders. I have in the past spoken to you in our group at Thomas's farm in one of our retreats about this crew and the wonderful moments they captured inside the capsule, pictures of our planet Earth. One of the pictures is now commonly known as the Earthrise from the words these men used. Listen, here is the point. Astronauts are not trained to be poets. Yet these men described what they saw from space in such beautiful poetic language to an audience, some 500 million people watching on Christmas Eve of that year, that needed to hear and understand how the outer space looked like from our planet. One of the lines from Lovell went like this, and I quote, "The vast loneliness up here of the moon is awe-inspiring. It makes you realize just what you have back there on Earth. The Earth from here is a grand oasis in the big vastness of space." He's speaking these words from space. If you like to read, you know that philosophers and scientists for centuries have reflected and theorized on the vastness and mystery of our Mother Nature, of our planet. If you know this, you'll appreciate that the language and texture that these fighter pilots used, people who had no background in poetry, was meant to break down this complicated subject to their watching and listening audience, read customers, in a language these customers could easily relate to. Let me tell you, sometimes to simplify means to learn a new way and to begin to see things differently. Let me go to number three and I close. Number three is demographics. Demographics in this area of customer service. Now, when I was growing up, sugar was a very rare commodity that we used to line up for on designated market days in our village. My mother used to cane us for stealing sugar and sucking it, from the palm of our hands. In later years, when I was a student at university, I would go with friends driving to Jinja or Tororo, and I always loved the beauty and greenery stretching over the hills of Buikwe and Usoga by the sugarcane plantations that many of you know in our country. At my age now, I see sugar very differently. I approach it from the view of a processor who has no market enough for their product, just like the struggle we have had with our milk products. When you grow, you become more reflective and you make more connections between things. Uganda has a high sugar production at over 450,000 metric tons because of our good climate that makes canes yield faster than our neighbors. Yet we consume less than 300,000 metric tons. Now, the jobs we lose because we cannot sell to East Africa unless we deal with local in-country petty politics, even though we are all building towards the political union, bothers me very much. I also now see sugar from a taxation point of view and how much it brings into the country's coffers. I also see sugar from the farmer's perspective, a farmer who earns only Uganda shillings 110,000 per ton. He must plant not less than 10 acres for this to make sense as a business. But you know, given the land fragmentation in these areas of sugarcane growing, it is hard to achieve this acreage for many households. And wait a minute. When you get closer to these plantations and see the cane cutters emerge from the forest of canes looking brown, sweaty, tired, and almost looking dazed, well, you begin to have a negative feeling about this crop's beauty, which you have always watched from a distance. You could turn into a sugar critic rather than a buyer. Well, this is not unlike seeing cows on a hill when the sun is setting, and how different it is when you see traditional milkers squatting in cattle dung heaps in the middle of the rain, milking these reluctant creatures in the morning that kick at them at every turn. The purpose of this example is that products must transit across several customer demographics. Each segment in growing over time has different buying habits, tastes, preferences, and a varying level of income. I'm sure you've seen telecom sell postpaid data or voice products to a certain age and earning bracket for individuals and corporate companies, while at the same time emphasizing prepaid for a majority of their customers, some of whom will at some point transit to the first category I mentioned. You have seen soft drinks and alcohol sellers miniaturizing products into small packets to get to the lowest of income earners to buy often, and you have also to buy more often. You have also noticed that a security company service means different things to different segments of the demographics. To an old couple, security might mean someone physically strong, armed with a weapon, but able to talk and help lonely people. To corporates, it might mean reception and front desk services. To hospitals, it could be accident and emergency services. To hotels, it might be swimming pool safety attendants. Well, all I have described above mean different perception and even language depending on the customer's income, age, and location. When you combine all these, you begin to see a pattern emerging on how they buy your products by their categories. When a segment has a certain depth of income, then you can tell how long, how deep, how sustainable your product will be with them, and therefore your investment in this market, and vice versa if the story is different. This will guide how your innovation and creativity is in serving these customers, how it should be in serving these customers. Well, I'd like to stop here. I want to thank you. Those of you who raised questions about the last topic, I'll answer them in our next segment. God bless you as we all stand together and fight to stay innovative and alive in this lockdown. Bye-bye.